Sarah, thank you so much for being on here. As we were just chatting before we got started here, early start to the day. I'm excited for it. Couldn't think of a better way to get this day rolling, but with starting an interview with you, and I'm really stoked on it.
Oh, thank you, Jacob. That's very kind. Well, there's nothing that I'd like to do more at 1 p.m.
There's got to be something. Maybe lunch or something.
No, I already had the lunch, so that was a peak, and now up I go again.
I think it's but we'll see. We'll see if we really go downhill from here.
So good, bro.
Possible. And as we were chatting before about coffee and all this stuff, morning rituals and what have you, because I'm at 5 a.m. right now, so I'm ready to rock. This is the peak time, as we were just saying. This is my golden hour.
Sure.
Between 5 and 6, yeah.
That's it. It's when you're getting everything done.
Right. I mean, I'm to bed at 6, so everybody knows that. So
exactly. Early to bed, early to rise.
Bingo. Do you usually wake up early? Are you an early riser?
Historically, no. But recently, I've become more accustomed to waking up a little bit earlier, just because I like to try and now get some exercise in. I got back into my exercise over when I was in Australia. Like, I've always been pretty good with exercising and like moving and stuff, but like, I just really ramped it up when I was back home, and then I've taken that back to the UK. And because, yeah, we've been rehearsing almost every day since I got back. And, you know, like, once you're kind of done with a rehearsal, like, it's kind of hard to push yourself to go to the gym or go swimming or something. So, yeah, before rehearsals, I've been trying to do. So that means me getting up a little earlier. Not always, though, but
it's just part of the practicing. You're just practicing for yourself as well.
Yeah, exactly that. Exactly that. But I like it. There's like a certain psychological buzz you get from waking up early and like doing stuff early. I think, like, if I wake up at like midday or something, like that's never felt good for me. I'm not saying I haven't done it plenty of times, but you know what I mean? You kind of just feel like, oh God, what am I doing?
Yeah. I've been there. You go, oh man, it's noon and I'm waking up now. Ooh.
Yeah, exactly. I don't know. You just feel like you've lost daylight, part of your day. You have.
Right. Yeah. It's true. But then you're a night owl at that point. And then that's just a whole nother state of being.
I don't think I'm that much of a night owl though. You see, like, I think like, midnight, I'm happy to go to bed, even earlier. Like, I've been pumped. I mean, gosh, with the jet lag, I was going to bed at like 9 p.m., 9:30. It was great. I loved it. But yeah, it does cut down the nighttime.
Yeah, which also sucks. You know, you got to take the good with the bad.
Exactly. It has its merits.
Right. Right. So you went back home, and home is Australia, correct?
That's correct.
Wow. Right. What part of Australia?
I'm originally from Perth, which is on the west coast, but my family probably for the last 20 years or so has been living in Melbourne. So I fly to Melbourne, and then, yeah, just hung out in Melbourne, went to South Australia for a bit because my boyfriend lives, his family lives in South Australia. He lives here.
Went to meet the parents, right? That's always nice.
I've met them many a time. We've been going out for like 14 years, so
meeting them again
many a times. Yeah, they've seen me a lot. But yeah, it was great.
They know you. They know you around there. You're local.
Yeah, they've seen my face before. They're like, oh, Sarah. Yeah, great. Good to see you. Yeah. I don't know. I love being in Australia. It's nice to disconnect a little bit.
Yeah, it's always important to detach yourself a little bit from whatever you're doing.
I think so. At a certain point. Yeah, like kind of step out of it. We had a really, really crazy year last year, like in a great way, obviously. But like by the end of the year, I like I was like pretty depleted with energy. So it was nice to just go home and be taken care of for a little bit.
Sure. That's always nice.
Yeah, it is.
Now, what drew you out to England? What made you want to do that?
I came here to pursue music. It was solely just because of that. I finished my university. I have a degree in biomedical science.
So very I did nice. That.
Yeah, pretty good one to have. But to be honest with you, I never much saw myself becoming like a scientist. Like, I'm just interested in science. I think it's cool. I can't say I was all that competent in lab work, probably because of my age as well at the time. But man, like, I don't know if anyone would want me, you know, coming up with cures for stuff. I'd probably put the wrong thing in the wrong thing or something. But so I was just doing that for a while, but I'd always wanted to come here. It's just something I just always had this in my mind. I mean, for me, it's, you know, the type of music that I like to do. You know, the US is always, you know, you always think like, oh, should I pursue music in the US? Because there's such a big market there and there's an amazing music scene in the US. But obviously, like, I don't have any type of green card or visa. You know, it's difficult. So my father was born in Scotland. So I had the means to come and live and work and stuff in the UK. So I did that solely to pursue music. So I came here after I'd finished my university degree and then went to a music school in Hackney because, I just was like, well, maybe this is a good way to meet some people because I didn't know anybody here. And now here I am, still here, doing the music.
And you know a bit more people now.
Couple more, yeah, a couple more faces.
Just a handful.
Yeah. Made a couple of connections. It was good.
That's all you need. It's just a couple.
Well, hey, just you don't need quantity, you need quality connections. That's it.
That's true. That's a true point right there. I can't deny that. That's true. So
I'm with you.
We're on the same page, Sarah.
Mm.
So you came to the UK to do music. Was it with the intent of creating a new band or just to see what the scenes had to offer?
I don't know at the time, to be honest. I don't think I really knew at the time. I was like, because I came and my main instrument is drums, really. Like, so I came here as a drummer being like, well, that's going to be my bread and butter. So whether that was, you know, sessioning for people or touring with another artist or forming my own band, I didn't actually really know at the time. I wouldn't call myself like a songwriter or anything at the time. Like, I sort of knew a little bit of guitar, but mostly what I was studying at the school was drums. So I think at that time I was just looking for bands to join and maybe looking for artists to drum for. I don't know. I was kind of just putting a lot of things out there and seeing, and, you know, just saw what stuck, really. And then by the end of my time at the music school, I started to then become a teacher at the music school, which was pretty great for me.
Student becomes the teacher.
Yeah, exactly. Classic. That. Exactly. Classic. That. No, the owner of the school was really, really kind to me, and he gave me my first job teaching drums, you know, which was a real boost because it's pretty, I don't know, like anything creative or stuff like that, it can be really hard to get your foot in the door, especially when, like me, I was so inexperienced with life and I was like, I don't know how to get a job. What do I do? How do I write a CV? What do I put on the CV? You know, like I had none of these. Speaking to you now about it, it's like I don't think I actually had really very much life skills at the time. I was like, I don't know. I'd come out of university. Everything was like, you know, I was living on like a campus and my meals were provided for me. And then after that, I was living at my parents' house. You know, I didn't have a lot of, you know, I didn't have a lot of know-how with life. So through at least the school, I was able to be like, right, well, teaching is a really good avenue for me to support myself while I figure out what I'm going to do.
Right. You know, and create music. Figure it out. Yeah. You figured exactly. out you're on an adventure. You said
exactly that. Exactly that. And I just,
I got to go
as I went. But no, it turned out really well. Cause then in my time at the music school, I met a girl called Leah Emery, who I'm still friends with.
One of the couple that you've
yeah, eventually. Yeah, exactly. Harnessed. Exactly that. The couple that I've managed to scoop up over the years. But I met her and she's Josie's best mate.
Mm.
So Josie plays bass. She's from the same town, Moshaping.
Fan favorite of the podcast. Gotta tell you, Sarah.
Yeah.
Best. Go check out her interview if you haven't after this
Do
one.
Do so. She's very charming.
She is. And her boyfriend as well.
Oh,
Mr. Noon Garden.
Oh, God. That man. Love him. Actually makes me emotional because it just doesn't get better than Charles. Love
one of
that.
The sweetest guys. Go check that one out as well. Also had yes. Charles on. Yeah.
Oh, there is just... So, we're going to segue into Charles for a second, but there is just so much goodness in that man. And he's so talented. Like he just... The other week, we shot a video, like we shot a music video. I'm not even kidding. We used iPhones because it was like meant to be this can. It's called Tequila. And like we put it on like a tequila bottle. So like the phone would like film us taking shots and like we filmed it. And then we just gave it to him and he just edited it. Bang, 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 bang. Boom. Music video. Done. Charles.
If anybody's going to do it, it's going to be him. I mean, let's just be honest here. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. He's the best. Anyway, sorry. I digress. Love you, Charles. Love you, Josie.
Love you, Charles. He's
great. Anyway, so I met Leah and then she was like, oh, I'm studying. I think she was studying like sound engineering or something. And then, yeah, she asked me to drum on some demos for her. And turns out she was a pretty damn good songwriter. A very, 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 very good songwriter. And yeah, those demos ended up getting picked up by a record label. And then, that was like my first sort of step into the world of like, you know, what does it mean to be on a label? What's a publishing deal? What does it mean to go on a tour? You know, recording, which I love. Love recording. That was like my first kind of segue into that whole world. So it worked out pretty well, actually. That school was good.
I would say so. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And now here I am.
Now, even before that, you were in a couple of bands playing drums as well, right? You had a little taste of that before getting into like the quote unquote like normality of real side of it without labels and whatnot.
Totally. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, my first one was in high school, but we were doing covers. I think we did like, we played at my school's, like we had this like little school festival and me and some of the, we had like, yeah, one of the girls from my class was just playing bass. Another girl was singing. And then we had two guys from our like brother's school, because I went to an all girls school. That two of friends of ours from like our brother's school, we came, yeah, we like got together and yeah, played a gig. But I did some stuff in university as well. But and then like, yeah, I was with a few other bands as well in London before. Yeah, I did the whole Kid Wave thing. I played in a band called Dead Wolf Club. We actually did a little bit of recording with that, but that wasn't like, I wouldn't say that was like on the same scale as like Kid Wave, because I wasn't together with them for as long, but yeah, still it's all good experience. I think sure. You can always learn something and take something out of anything.
That's a true statement right there. Again, I cannot I cannot argue this, Sarah.
Absolutely. And people from Alwyn and Martha, still friends with them as well. They're great.
Again, some of the people, a couple of picks.
Yeah.
And throughout these projects that you just mentioned, you were only playing drums in those bands?
Right.
Wow.
Yeah. I think I may have like recorded acoustic guitar for like one Kid Wave song that we like, it was like a cover song we did. And I was like, I want to play acoustic guitar. Let me do it. And I think Lee was like, okay, fine. Okay. But yeah, by no means I would have definitely considered myself quite a basic guitarist, if anything, at the time. I would probably had started to write some music. But yeah, nothing like what I'm doing now with Los Bichos, I don't think.
So when did guitar become more prominent within your life? Was it right around that time?
I think I'd say actually as Kid Wave was maybe wrapping up. So the band that, yeah, I'd been like, we were together for maybe like what? 4 years, 5 years, maybe something like that. And then the singer moved to the States, and then we for a little while to pursue her songwriting. And then, you know, like at that time, then I was like, okay, well, that project's kind of wrapping up. I don't have much else to do. Like I wasn't playing with drums with really many other bands. I was kind of maybe dabbling with some friends' projects. A friend of mine, Andy, does a project called Purs, which I ended up playing drums for on his album, which is pretty cool. But I don't know. I think it was around that time where I was like, I'm going to just try writing some songs and see what might happen with that. So I just, stuck my head down and learned Ableton and got some help. I don't know, just got help from friends and some producers that I knew at the time, just who would help me out with, figuring out how to actually work Ableton and how to like record a guitar onto Ableton and like how maybe to use like, you know, what does a compressor do? Why does this guitar sound terrible? Maybe you should EQ it.
Right. And I still don't think anybody knows what a compressor does. I mean, if you know, please comment it below, because
I'm sure we'll get someone who has the Webster's dictionary definition down there.
Charles would know that. I'm just saying, Charles knows.
Of course he would.
Off
but he said in a loving, in a lovely, kind, non-condescending. But anyway, started writing. It wasn't necessarily solo stuff. It wasn't Los Bichos stuff. It was more kind of solo stuff for me that I was writing at the time. So, but eventually I just started doing like this instrumental music as a bit of fun, because I don't know, not really comfortable writing lyrics for whatever reason. Just, you know, when you hear someone sing something and you're like, yeah, like that's good, or like, you know, when they say something and even if you were to sing it back, you're like, this is good. But then sometimes if you're, I don't know, lyrics can be a bit funny. I've just never been too comfortable writing them. I don't think that's a skill I necessarily hold. So I kind of shied away from that after a while and then just kept on with the instrumental stuff, which I much more enjoyed. I thought I had more knack with doing that.
Do you feel like you'll eventually get to the point that you will want to pen some lyrics to some songs?
I don't know.
Only time will tell.
It's nothing that's like, I can't say it's, you know, it's nothing that's like burning inside of me to do. I'm so happy writing instrumental music. I'm not saying like I wouldn't want to write the instrumentation and then have someone else come in and sing over it and do their lyrics over it. I'd always welcome that. But for me, I don't I don't know. I mean, I suppose never say never, right?
But, right.
Yeah, who knows? I think for me, it's just like I like the instrumentation. That's where my heart lies at the moment. Maybe next time I talk to you, I'll be like, oh, I've written all these lyrical songs, and it's like.
The next time you come on, brand new album.
Recording an album.
Really looking forward to that one, Sarah.
Yeah, me too. Can't wait.
What is another instrument that you would like to learn how to play besides drums and guitar? What would be like the third option? You'd be like, oh yeah, that'd be cool to grasp that to the ability of where you are on the guitar now. Like that's where you would reach with this third.
I reckon instrument. It could be interesting to try like brass or wind instruments. I have no ability for that. Like I can't even make a sound. I don't know how people play. Like I mean I understand how they're doing it, but my hat goes off to people who can play or excel at playing, like trumpet, saxophone, tuba. Me and my boyfriend went to this after party of Kamasi. It was like a small show of Kamasi Washington, if you're familiar with his music.
I am not, but good.
Check him out. He's amazing. And he's a predominantly a jazz musician. But I think he's done collaborations with Thundercat and a few other people. But we went to this after show, and he was just performing. He just performed at the Roundhouse, which is a really, really large venue, and then he's come to this really small club and they played for a few hours. And there was this guy, like, you know, the rest of the musicians were kind of, you know, they were playing, but they were sort of coming in and out, taking breaks. There was a guy there on tuba. I mean, we left after, like, we left early after like 2 hours, and the guy was just tubering the whole time, like, like, wasn't even like having a glass of water, like nothing. It was just smashing this chair. I was like, how, like, what are that guy's lips like? Like, what's going on? So I would pick one of those. But if I could be more realistic, I'd like to be better at playing piano.
Okay. Piano, tuba, and a lot more singing on this next album. I'm really looking forward to it.
Yeah, it's just going to be that. It's going to be awesome.
Yeah. good melding of different ideas.
Yeah. Very, very experimental.
So going back to this, to using Ableton in all these different ideas that you were kind of floating out there, how did it eventually become Los Bichos? I mean, was it through the kind of the process I'm assuming that you were talking about before of having these songs turn into just instrumental pieces, and then it just kind of branched out from there?
Yeah. I mean, there was this one song that I'd written years ago. It was called, it's, you maybe now know it as The Link Is About to Die, which is on it's very much on our first album that we released, not last year. It's emphatically on there.
We're gonna check that out. We're gonna fix it in post if that is incorrect. Well, yeah, we're gonna fact check that, but yeah, please go ahead.
Absolutely. Do fact check that, everyone, please. It should still be on there, on all the new pressings anyway.
Revised.
But anyways, that song used to have lyrics to it. And I think at the time I didn't know anything from anything, so I was like, I just put it out, and I don't think it really did anything at the time. I just put it out, and it's probably still on YouTube, to be honest with you. And then, like, I don't know, like, I just had these little track ideas. And I was like, I don't know if it was just me being a bit lofty, but I was like, I don't know, like, these are good, but I'm like, maybe it's just the sound of my voice that's putting everyone off, which, I mean, not the first time I would have heard that, but.
Come on, Sarah. You're not fooling anybody. Everybody wants to hear those pipes.
But I mean,
come on, teasing this new album. Like, okay, we get it. You're creating buzz.
The piano. But I don't know. It was just something. I was just like, well, look, it's just, it hasn't worked. Something's just not hit when I've just put it out. You know, and of course, like, what was I expecting to become like a Justin Bieber overnight or something? Like, I don't know what I was expecting at the time, but I had these tracks and I was like, you know what? It just might be fun to just rework them and just put like a sort of guitar shred over it as much as I can. And at the time as well, like, I had started to listen to cumbia. There's this instrumental album, which is purely instrumental, called The Roots of Chicha. And it features a lot of Peruvian cumbia. And I think that album itself really inspired the process of me writing instrumental music. Because I was like, of course, music can be instrumental. I hear it all the time. I hear it in movies. Like for instance, you know, like the Home Alone, like, dun, 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 like, or in video games. I love video games. I love video game music. Like, some of my favorite pieces of all time are in video games. And I was like, well, of course, that this is like instrumental music totally works. So I was like, why don't I try something like this? You know, I'd never done it before. I'd never done much with it. And then over like that time, like, you know, I met Agustina, who was keen to join into like what I was doing. I mean, at the time, you know, in the really early days, there was no band. It was just like an idea, like an entity of Los Bichos. And then I think it wasn't really until we played our first gig, I think, that I was like, wow, people might actually like to see this. Because you don't know.
Right.
I don't know. But yeah, I don't know. What can I tell you? It was just something I tried. It's just something I tried, and it happened to resonate with people, which is great.
Did you, that must have been like a real turning point to like find where you wanted the sound and the feeling to be through discovering that record?
Certainly, absolutely. I mean, I think that particular record opened me up into like a whole new realm of songwriting, and just even realizing like what I liked in music. What do I want to hear? I mean, I love listening to people's voices and see how they can express themselves through that. And I think that's incredible.
Through that or the tuba, you know, whatever
exactly.
It is. Or
whatever the medium through whichever is. Medium you choose, of course. But I love the instrumental parts of those songs as well. Like, I think, God, what was my earliest memory of this? Okay, you must know what I'm talking about. That solo in November Rain.
November Rain. Oh, in that Guns N' Roses. Oh,
yeah. So you know when, like, you know, it's that build up, like at the very end. And then Slash climbs up on Axl Rose's piano and he's like, damn, damn. And I just, I think I was like, I must have been like, I don't know, five, like a child. And I just remember being like, yeah, this is good. Like, this is great. Like, obviously the rest of November Rain is great, but that slaps. Like, that instrumentation at the very end of that was just unreal. So it's always resonated, I guess, but I think it was, it wasn't until that moment of like, wow, there's a whole album of instrumentals and like people have listened to it. It wasn't until, I kind of got my head around that it was when I started, to actually like write instrumental music.
Very interesting. Now, I gotta go back a little bit here to what you were saying before, that when you met Augustine, and you met Josephine. And I've had the pleasure of having both them on the podcast. And go check those episodes out if you haven't after this one. And I got their perspective of joining the band. But I wanted to ask you your perspective of them joining the band and bringing Nick into the fold as well. Was that it seems like a very organic kind of thing that just sort of happened, and it happened at the right time with the right people.
Yeah. Well, Augustine is one always cracks me up because she just asked. I don't know why. I don't know. I guess just knowing her and knowing the type of amazing person that she is. I think that's one thing I really admire about her. She always puts herself out there, and she couldn't play anything. Like her CV was empty when she came into the band.
But she was willing to learn. That's what's important.
She'd come to my house. Well, first of all, I was like, well, what can you play? She was like, nothing. I kind of used to like sing in a punk band back in Uruguay, but she was like, well, this is an instrumental band, so something else. I was like, how about guitar? Like, could you learn that? And she was like, yeah, sure. So she'd come to my house every week or a few times a week to learn. So we'd like have little lessons together. I mean, I wouldn't say I'm like the world's greatest piano teacher, but like I could, you know, I was like teaching her the basics and stuff. And yeah, she learned the keyboard. So she just I think from her account, I think it's just something she's always wanted to do, and she was just willing to try, willing to put herself out there, which I really, really, in hindsight, I think that's really, really cool. I really, really respect her for that, because that's not easy. It's not an easy thing to learn an instrument. It's not an easy thing to then freshly play that instrument in front of people. Like, none of that stuff is easy. It's not easy to be in a band, but she's really, really, over the years, she's just really, really honed in her skills, and it's been really, really cool to see her develop in the band and just to see all the stuff that she does. But she, yeah, at the time, she just asked. She was like, I want to do it. And I was like, oh, you're in. You've got the job. Congratulations.
Strict vetting process for this band.
Yeah, exactly.
You gotta ask.
Yeah, it's true. You don't ask, you don't get.
That's true.
But yeah, I mean, before Josie and Nick joined, we were predominantly actually getting some of our friends to mostly fill in on like bass and drums and extra guitar and stuff. But that wasn't really an issue because at the time we didn't have that many gigs anyway. Like, it's not like it is now where we have quite a rigorous touring schedule. Like, this is in really early days of the band. Like, we didn't have a booking agent, didn't have a manager, we didn't have anything. You know, we'd take the bus to a gig. And I'm not talking about like, you know, just like a London bus. Like, we'd take like a coach out of town in like winter to like go play a gig for like 15 people and then come back on that same coach being like,
that's what true musician tough though. There it is.
Oh my god,
you went through stuff to get this done.
Oh god,
went through the weather.
Oh man, hold on, whereabouts are you right now?
Southern California, so it doesn't get
there.
That
you go, you got no idea on how. You don't know. No. Cold, man.
No, not me. But I've heard, I got a nice app on my phone that tells me what's going on. Okay. Where.
Yeah. No, we do it pretty rough here in the UK, especially in winter. It's nice and sure.
What year are we talking about around here? Like these are
2017, I reckon. Would have been 2017, and then I think 2018 rolled around. And then I think we were starting to get more offers for shows around that time anyway, or at least, yeah, like there was just more stuff was happening. And then I think we were coming to a stage of like, we really need to start having some permanent members, because it was just getting a bit stressful, to be honest with you, trying to like be like, right, we've got a gig booked here. Who can play drums? Who can learn the songs? You know, because we'd you know, not everyone's always going to be available. So you might have to then re-rehearse again with some different people and, you know, whatnot. And I think, yeah, we just wanted a more permanent lineup. And I'd known Josie for so many years by that time, and it just had so happened that she had left her band and was bandless at the time. And then as soon as that happened, I made sure to scoop her up, because she not only is a really, really lovely person, but she is a wicked bass player. She's just so good. I think one of my favorite things about Josie is like, she just is so in the pocket. She's not overtly fancy, which a lot of bass players can be, you know, like just
right, not super flashy, but it's still I mean, I'll tell you, I mean, I've tried, I was like, oh, let me see what she's doing. I can't grasp it, but yeah, it's definitely like, it's not too flashy. Like you were saying,
it's not just out there. The pocket, which is exactly
where she,
in my opinion, where bass players need to be. If you could just, you know, do that while also killing it with ridiculously fantastic melodic bass lines, then yeah, you've got the job. And that's exactly what Josie has. Just yeah, really good ideas, really tasteful playing.
Tasty, yeah, licks for sure.
Mm-hmm. Yes, definitely. And we were really lucky that she said yes. And then, so that was okay. But then we were like, God, finding a drummer is going to be murder, because it's hard to find a good drummer. It just is. Drums are hard.
Sure. Did you ever contemplate doing the drums and finding another guitarist, or were you already?
No. Actually, fixated. I'd love to play drums as well. Like, if I could, I would, but I can't physically do that. Well, not yet anyway.
We'll see. Further down the line, next album. Yeah,
we'll see if I'm able to. I don't know. I mean, I'd love to play drums for Bitchos, but I just, because like I write, if the way that the guitar is, like me trying to teach that to someone. And also, you know, like, I don't know, the guitar is just what I've written, and it's the voice, and I just couldn't sort of get my head around trying to teach that to someone else. It'd be very difficult. So I think, yeah, it was just best that we found like a really, really, really good drummer, to fill that spot. Otherwise, yeah, like, because by that point I would have been playing the lead for like about 2 years or something. So, you know, then just kind of switching the whole band around didn't make much sense for me. So I think I just kept on at the lead, and we were like, no, let's get someone, you know, who's playing drums. And then we just found Nick via Facebook. We just put out a status and we were like, anyone? And then I think she was the only one I clicked on, and I was like, this one. And I just met her, and she was really lovely. She bought me some gingerbread.
I mean, what a way to get into a band right there,
dude. You're all, in
all the aspiring musicians that listen to this, buy take some note. Gingerbread,
some gingerbread, or maybe a little cupcake. That's always nice. I enjoy little cupcakes or something. You don't have to bring me anything, but it was a nice gesture.
But I mean, you don't want to come empty-handed to anything.
Yeah, a little chocolate or something. That's
sure,
nice.
sure. Absolutely. Hershey's or something. You got to bring something to the table. Not Hershey's.
I'm very, very sorry, US, but I can't do the Hershey's.
Who makes the best chocolate? Is it Belgium? Is it England.
Like what country?
Well, yeah.
Belgian chocolates. We could Swiss. Oh, Swiss chocolate out of control. UK is doing some pretty okay chocolate. But I'm finding like the Hershey's has some sort of other taste that I can't get on with.
Okay. All right.
Yeah. Must be the sugar content.
Funny that you mentioned that because that kind of leads us into our ad. Hershey's chocolate. Thanks for talking shit on them.
Sort it out.
We'll leave it in. we do not agree with the reflection shown about Hershey's chocolate. No, there's better chocolates out there. I'll be honest. Hershey's not my favorite.
What's your favorite one?
I would say Heath bar, which okay. is yeah the toffee one. Yeah.
Can you get that in do I have to go to like a shop, like a specific shop, or can I just grab it from like a gas station or something?
You can definitely grab it from a gas station. I don't know anybody else who's grabbing those from the gas station. Oh,
okay. So, just you.
Yeah. I mean, but that's on a rare occasion. So
okay.
That's not like a normal thing.
I'm heading to the US in April. So
you'll be grabbing one. Yeah.
Sure.
This is shit. And then you're going to throw it away.
Probably, like, to be honest. Because you know what, though? So listen to a podcast about chocolate, because I love that.
I'm so glad that you're bringing up another podcast on a podcast, Sarah.
Absolutely. Please. Don't worry. We're not going to mention the name.
Drop the name. Do it. Do it, like, and we'll bleep it.
Podcast thing. It's really good. But they're saying that, and I'm pretty sure it would affect the US. Every country has its own rules about how much cocoa and sugar, etc., is allowed in chocolates. And I'm telling you, FDA, yes. Man, I reckon they're allowing like 10 times the amount of sugar that like the UK and like rest of the world is. Like, I ate a Snickers last year in the US, couldn't finish the Snickers, had to like palm the rest off
wasteful.
To my boyfriend.
That's I was wasteful. Like,
I can't eat this Snickers, it's too sugary.
You're wasting food in the US?
No, I wasn't.
Very nice.
I'm telling you, he ate it.
Sure.
But also did mention it was quite sugary. Not enough cocoa. Yeah.
Look, I don't know who I got to speak to about these issues, Sarah. I will try to get on the horn.
Call the FDA and be like, oi, got some feedback for you.
Yeah, well, I think they blocked my number from the last couple of times. Yeah. I got drunk and prank called them a couple of times. Again, FDA, I apologize. It was just me.
The US does a lot of other fantastic foods, though. It was just the chocolate I had a slight issue with.
What was your favorite that you had?
Oh, I love the barbecue.
So when you were in Texas, yeah?
Yeah, love that. Love the barbecue. Love the fried chicken. I even love like the little fancy restaurants, like the actual like culinary talents of people.
The Arby's
in the US. The Arby's. Yeah. Hey, respect. Love those. I don't know. US is great for food. Just not so much the chocolate.
Overall. Better food than England, or England better than America on the food?
Ooh. I don't think I'd actually say which one's better. I'd say both have their merits. And it depends what you like as well. But I think UK is doing excellent food. It's had a bit of a bad reputation.
It has. I'll be honest. On this side of the world, people do talk mad shit.
Totally, absolutely. I remember on an episode of The Sopranos, even Tony Soprano wrote off.
How many times are we just going to plug other people's stuff? You don't watch, listen,
HBO.
Don't watch HBO, don't watch The Sopranos, don't listen to these other podcasts. It's just The Vineyard.
Just do this one. Well, you don't need to see The Sopranos now because You just had that, and that's all you need to know about that show.
There you go. Some gabagool.
Yeah.
Have been watching The Wire
lately. Love The Wire.
Very slow. I'm still watching it. I'm on season two. Everything's fucked. I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, it's not going to get much better. I can tell you that much. There's not going to be, yeah, there's no solace. There's no like times where you're like, oh, that was a fun episode. But it's just very good.
Okay. All right.
Yeah. Oh, I'm happy for you. That's a good shout.
I'll keep on pushing on that, because I remember hearing about people like, oh, it's so good. The Wire. And now I'm watching. I'm like, okay.
Yeah. Like, damn, that is good.
I would say it kind of feels like Law and Order.
That's what it feels like. Okay. I don't mind a little bit of Law and Order now and then. Didn't the guy just, one of the main dudes from that just passed away the other week, right?
Richard Belzer.
Yeah. Comedian. Oh, man, rest in peace.
Yeah, comedian Richard Belzer.
Yeah, that's a big loss to the Law and Order community. He was on that for, like, the whole time.
Sure, yeah.
That man is Law and Order.
That's it. But I always think of that other guy. What's his name? Christopher Maloney, I think is his name. The dude is kind of like the shaved head. He always wears a tie.
I'd have to look him up.
And I might have the name wrong, and I apologize if I do, Chris. I'm sorry. But I always think of him.
Chris Maloney.
Okay, cool. All right. Got the name right. I always think of him when I think of Long Island.
Oh, actually, no. This isn't the right. I'm getting like a British singer.
Sure. Yeah. Yeah. Let's just
say you're right. Well done. There you go. It's him.
That was fact checked. Sarah, now going back to music, I know that we strayed away because of your slanderous views of chocolate in the US.
Yeah, the chocolate thing. Yeah, sorry about that.
Yeah. Yeah, you can leave a comment below, Sarah. We'll read them. Yeah.
Yeah.
And we'll actually put her phone number out right now. So if you want to give her a ring and chat with her about.
Love to talk to you about it.
Mm-hmm. About how Hershey, PA, because it's in Pennsylvania, I believe. Hershey, Pennsylvania.
Okay.
So, yeah, a lot of fans over there. Central Pennsylvania, Harrisburg, that kind of.
Well, hello.
Yeah.
I love the fans. Just, yeah.
Just not the chocolate. We get it. It's fine. What was the first time jamming with Nick, Josephine, and Augustine alike for you? Was that like, did you feel in that moment that, oh shit, we really do have something here?
I wouldn't say, if I'm honest, I can't remember many rehearsals. I remember the gigs though. Because, I mean, me and Agustina had played together for a little bit before that formation. And I'd be lying to you if I said I was like, oh, I remember like this rehearsal when I was like, yeah, this came together. But for me, when I really feel that it comes together is like when we've been on stage together and you get that feeling. You just get that feeling, you know, like you're sort of doing your thing and like you look around and, you know, you see all the girls doing their bit. And we're having a really good time. And, you know, it's even over the years, like the crowds and stuff have grown. And I think those are the moments that I can tell that we have something really special, or where I've felt that anyway. I don't know what they're feeling, but it's just to even just to look over and just to see everyone doing their thing. I think those moments, and there's been so many of those moments, particularly last year. Even the year before, once we were allowed to hit the ground running again, those moments of just us being together on stage, those are what I remember. And yeah, that, I don't know, it's, I don't think it's something I can describe easily with words, but, you know, it's like when you know, I think, you know, when something feels right, don't need to, you know, it's like, you can't even necessarily explain it.
Sure.
But I think just the way that we are with each other on stage and off stage. It's just, it's special.
Yeah, I've mentioned this before. I did catch you guys in LA. Don't remember the, I think the last time you guys played.
The Moroccan and Lounge?
The Moroccan Lounge, exactly. I was there.
Were you for that.
Sure. Yeah, I was there. I bought a shirt. I supported. Yeah.
Did you come in? You must have. Okay, I'm going to just put a little disclaimer on that. Our publisher, Scott, he bought us this. You have these like fancy bottles of tequila in the US, and they have like a little bell on the top. Don't know if Josie showed it to you in her podcast. Anyway, we were smashing that bottle. We were like drinking all these other tequilas. I was like smashing beers. Like we were pretty drunk at that show, but like in a great way, you know, like we were having such a good time.
Right. And
so I must have met you at, because I was, or my boyfriend did, because he was selling merch.
Definitely did meet him. Yeah. Through like the little side thing. Yeah.
And
I
are you gonna come to our next one, Jacob?
I actually sure am. In San Diego on April something. I don't have the date in front of me, but and if there is still tickets, go. We got the research. Can we pull that up,
Sarah? Yeah. I'm pulling it up right now. San Diego, April 14th. I was right.
Definitely go and buy tickets for that, because that's gonna be a special one. Going back to my original statement of seeing you guys there at the Moroccan Lounge, I really felt like you were saying, from an audience perspective, that you guys were all on the same wavelength and having a good time, and it was just all fun, and it was fun to be in the audience, and everybody was you know, dancing. Yeah,
that's just what it is. I mean, you know, you're always going to have ups and downs when you're traveling with people, or, you know, personal ups and downs, group ups and downs. You're tired, you're this, you're that, I don't know. All this stuff can happen when you're traveling together and you're working together and all of that. But God, there have been so many times where I've just felt horrendous before showtime, like whether it's emotionally, physically, both of those things. And then as soon as I go on stage, whatever was happening or whatever I felt just melts away, you know? And I just know that the girls are there to support me. We support each other. Something's happening, we'll, you know, we'll lift each other up, or we'll talk about it. And I think, yeah, that just having that support, relentless support, I think makes such a difference. And yeah, it's nice that can be conveyed.
Yeah,
because it is. We just have such a good time playing the show and doing what we do, selling merch afterwards, like the whole thing. It's like, yeah, it's great. What can I say?
That's awesome. Now, when, you know, your worries and whatever else, anxiety or stress or whatever it may be, whatever emotion is, it kind of just washes away, like you said, when you get on stage. What is going through your mind when you are on stage playing these songs?
Me, I'm thinking about the song, and I'm thinking about what I'm playing. And for me, it's like, I know this with myself because I'm catching myself doing it now. Once I start to be like, oh, what was that email that I wrote? Plunk. You know, or what was this that I said? Like, I lose it. So for me, I am I'm working anyway on my concentration. My concentration is not great at the best of times. So for me, I'm thinking about where I am in the song, guitar stuff, everything. I'm just trying to engross myself in the moment. That's me.
So you're just so disconnected from whatever's going on stage. You're not even paying attention, basically. That's what you're telling me. You're half there. Got it.
Yeah, I'm just thinking about what I'm having for dinner.
Each their own. I mean, whatever you got to focus on to get through it.
Absolutely. No, I mean, it's nice. It's nice. I think We do like to joke around on stage as well, which is pretty cool. I like that. It's like, I never feel like anxious or nervous, especially when playing with the girls, because it's just like, you know, even if it's like a little technical something goes wrong, you know, it's easy to laugh it off or to laugh about something. I don't know. It's just, it's like nothing else matters. It's like, it, I feel like it's a really nice protected space. It's like just playing at a party, really. Like at a, playing at a friend's party. That's what I feel like. It's nice.
Just playing at friends' parties.
Yeah, yeah. Just sometimes the parties are quite big.
And maybe a little bit loud. And maybe somebody gets thrown out of the party.
Yeah, exactly.
And plus you're selling merch at a party? Kind of crazy.
Why not?
I guess. What drives you to continue to create music?
I think just the anticipation of what you can create next.
That shit was really dramatic. I'll tell you that, Sarah.
Yeah.
It was a long pause and I was like, oh, boy. Who?
I think so. It's just, I mean, I think music is just such a joy. It can lift you up. It can take you to places that, you know, you might want to go, you didn't think you could go. And I think it's the mystery in what you can create next that I think drives me. And what might you even use that music for? You know, will it be for a band situation? Will it be for, you know, a body of work for like an orchestra? Will it be for a video game? Will it be for a film? I don't know. It's like, I think that anticipation and that mystery is what drives me to keep creating. And, you know, I think even getting inspired by other people's work and then just that being propelled by their work and being inspired by their work, I think is a really, really exciting place to be creatively. I love that. I love when you hear someone else's, like, I just love hearing like someone else's bit of music and you're like, God, that is so good. And that just propels you to create your own. I think that's really exciting as well. There's a lot of factors, but, and then of course the joy of then performing that music.
I like that answer, Sarah.
Yeah. And recording it. I do also enjoy
I don't like that. Yeah, up until the recording.
Could have kept it at the last one, mate.
Yeah. Shit. When you recorded Let the Festivities Begin, how what was going through your mind at that time? How were you viewing it? Were you like, this is, it's fucking happening, we're doing this, this is crazy? Or
yeah, well, I don't know, at the time I think I was just going, God, I'm even trying now to think when we recorded that. 2020, possibly even end of 2019, we recorded some of that. That was probably one of the crazy, it was a pretty crazy time in my life. Lots of things were happening, lots of things were going on with me personally. Obviously, then we had a worldwide pandemic.
That was the personal stuff. I get it. Yeah.
Yeah. Don't know. It was just, I remember going, I don't know, like when you're going through it, you're kind of just being like, okay, this is what we're doing. I don't think in that time I was like, oh my God, this is like, it's like, for me, it's like I go through it and I'm living it and I do it. And then I reflect on it afterwards. But I think at the time it's like, wicked, you know, Alex Kapranos is willing to record with us, you know, he's willing to take these songs and work with us to produce an album. That's pretty damn cool. As a long-standing Franz Ferdinand fan as well, you know. At the time, I think just trying to make the best body of work possible was what was going through my mind, I think. But now being able to reflect on that time, yeah, it was nuts. Absolutely. Trying to finish that album off as well in the pandemic when you know, there's all those rules of like, you can be in the room with one other person, but the window has to be 10 centimeters open, or you can gather in a group, but only outside. And it's like, or, you know, you make plans to do it next week, but then new lockdown laws come in like 2 days later. And it's like, God, it was just crazy. But I think the way in which it worked out, it couldn't have been any better.
I kind of like that answer. There's a little bit of there that I didn't like. Situational wise.
Well, yeah, can't help that. What can we do? That's how it was.
Now, how was it for recording the newest release, the 7-inch that was just released the other day that we touched upon 4 hours ago?
But I like how you've circled back to it. Very professional. I like
Thank you. I'm learning the tricks of the trade. Anyways.
Yeah. I think the fact that we were again in between like tours, so we had the smallest amount of time. We had like a 2-week window or something to pull it off. And yeah, our label guy, Severin, hey Severin, he's a man of ideas, and I think, yeah, his enthusiasm definitely helps to drive these ideas and put them into fruition. He was like, guys, like next year, King Gizzard, what about like a 7-inch? And we're like, mate, how are we gonna do this? You know what I mean? It's like, we have no time, like when? But like, I think we just had this bit of drive and we just were like, right, let's get an email to our guy. We usually record at this place called 5DB Studios it's in West London with Javier Weyler. He engineered the first album and he's been doing these, he did our Christmas singles and he did, yeah, the singles right now as well. We love working with him, and yeah, he just had some time and we just got together some production notes and we just went in and just recorded that in, I think it was like 2-3 days. But I think, yeah, the fact that everyone's so prepared, we've been playing those songs for ages as well. So we just, in true Bitro style, no time to do anything, but we made the time and
did it, yeah, perfectly. That's
it worked out like beyond my wildest dreams, I think. Just especially like Tequila, I love it. I love hearing Agustina sing over that. I just love how unhinged it is. And Trapdoor, just to hear that actually like recorded all of us together, because we had initially, we'd released like a sort of more demo version of Trapdoor years ago, mm-hmm, on a small label called Strong Island Recordings, who have been so lovely and so helpful in to launch, you know, the band's career and stuff like that. They're just a really, really lovely bunch of people based down in Portsmouth. But we, yeah, the original one was just me. It was kind of more like a demo version, if you would, because I had just recorded it on Ableton. So there was that.
And nobody knows what the fuck is going on there.
Nah, God, no. I don't.
Charles,
I
still... but that's it. That's about it.
But anyway, it was nice to hear. It was just really nice to hear the version with all the girls on it. I think it doesn't get better than that for me. And I think especially like the drums sound so sick in that recording. I just love them. It was great. What can I say? With that little bit of drive, that little bit of push, you make the time, and it's just, I don't know. For me, recording music and being able to release that music is just the best thing ever. I love that process. That's where I don't know. I love being in a I just love being in like a studio environment and just hearing how a song can develop. That's really exciting. And then like editing it and seeing where little things can pop in and pop out. I think that's just, it's a fun process for me.
Do you feel more submerged and connected with the music, your music while you're in the studio or playing it live?
Both, but in different ways. Because when we're live, you can let it go a bit more wild. You know, you can maybe change something a little bit here. You can play it a little bit faster. You can extend some bits. You know, you can play with that recorded version a little bit more, which I think is really cool. And you can also, depending on the night and where you're playing, I think that song, you know, every song can sound different, or you can play it a bit differently. And also, yeah, you can really be in the moment and be connected to that song while playing it live. But in the studio, definitely. But I'm thinking about the song in a different way, because it's like, well, what does it sound like sonically? That cowbell being panned enough? Is that cymbal annoying? You know, like you're connected to it definitely, but you're thinking about things in for me anyway, I think about it in more of a technical way. And it's like, well, what does this invoke in me? Does it make me anxious? Does it make me a little annoyed? Is it something I can live with? But yeah, for me, yeah, two connections, but different.
Now, have you, with kind of getting more loose within playing these songs live, and the looseness of that also, of course, brings up different ideas, and you go down different ways of finishing a song or playing a song. Has that kind of invoked like, oh, maybe I should have done this song like this because this sounds good? Or are you of like, once the record's done, it's done?
Yeah, you got to let that go. Because sometimes for me, it's like you can, God, there's just no point in ruminating on stuff. You can sit there till the cows come home, tweaking things. There has to be a time when you put stuff down. Otherwise, if you're working on, it'll be like, I'm going to use Guns N' Roses again, it'd be like your Chinese Democracy. That yeah. album that took like 10 years, and then when it came out, not that good.
I don't like Guns N' Roses. It's not for me.
Oh, fair enough. Well, there you go. Chinese Democracy should have just never mind that album. I don't know why I'm on like such a Guns N' Roses thing today. I don't know what's going on with me with that.
You were so enthusiastic when you brought it up before. I was like, I'm not gonna say that I don't like it, or it's not my thing.
You don't have to like Guns N' Roses. I don't hold that against you. I only like the 90s Guns N' Roses anyway. Anything past that, I got no time for it.
She's just joking, Guns N' Roses. We still want to tour with you.
I'd say yes, absolutely. I love that era of music. It's wicked. Me and Agustin are actually going to go see Motley Crue. Speaking of like that era.
Sure.
I'm going to go see him, hopefully, in Sheffield, I think. We'd also love to tour with them, but we're not sure the music would connect. Yeah. Yeah, okay. Yeah,
my mom saw Prince and Rolling Stones together. You think that's the, you know, you gotta blend stuff sometimes.
Sorry, when did she do what? Yeah, Wicked.
When she was a teenager. Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah.
The thing is, though, I can see that kind of overlapping a little bit.
Yeah, it's a bit more, yeah. But just I was just giving an example. That was the first one. Okay, all right. How about this? I saw Ziggy Marley and Willie Nelson on the same day. I mean, those guys don't line up. How about that?
Wait, but were they in like a festival setting?
It was in a festival.
Okay, there you go, though. I'm talking like, did you go to a Willie Nelson concert and, you know, Ziggy Marley was opening up for Willie Nelson?
That is happening for his like 90th birthday. He has a bunch of people playing. Like Snoop Dogg is going to fucking be there and shit.
Love that.
Yeah.
Love that.
Lovely,
but I can
Nelson.
I can imagine those two have multiple connections to one another, if you get my drift.
No, I don't. Still...
Why? Because
they're musicians?
Well, yeah, and, you know, the whole Dubois thing.
Yeah, they smoke cigarettes, yeah. What about it?
Yeah, that's right.
Sarah, are you surprised with the amount of eyeballs and fans and success that you've garnered with this project over the past, I mean, what, 3 years ish, maybe 4 years?
I'm gonna say yes and no.
I keep on lobbing you up just a pitch, and you keep on just hitting it out, a yes and a no. Please. All elaborate.
Right. I'm gonna usually, well, you know what? A part of me, of course, is just like, you know, you don't know how anything's gonna go. You don't know, you know, you put a bit of music out there and you might think it's the best thing ever, but maybe no one else does. Or you can put a bit of music out there and you can be like, oh, this is not even that good. It's a bit of trash, but I'll put it out anywhere. Maybe it blows up. You don't know. You know, you just create your bit of art and then you just put it out there, and whatever happens with it really then happens. You know, it's not yours anymore. So it's like, from that perspective, of course, it's really amazing to see how many people have resonated with the band, have resonated with the music, how it's, you know, maybe introduced people to listening to more instrumental music compared to maybe beforehand. I think that's really, 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 really cool, and it's so fantastic to see how that keeps evolving, you know, with every release we do, or, you know, every tour we do. I think that's amazing. But then a part of me also, especially when we were creating this, I did have a little sense of something. I did have a feeling that I was like, this isn't like other people's projects that I'm seeing at the time. You know, most, and this is me, I come from like an indie rock background. You know, most bands I see, of course, you'll have, you know, especially if it's like four girls, what's the format? Of course, you'll have someone on drums, bass, guitar, singing. But I did know that we had a little bit of a twist, which is the instrumental thing. So from that respect, I was like, well, this is a bit different. And this is something that makes us stand out compared to other bands. So in that respect, I think we probably actually even got a little bit lucky with the timing of when we started Los Bichos, because there wasn't a lot of, you know, I don't think there were many other all-girl instrumental bands based in the UK doing like a mix of psychedelic cumbia and Turkish music and rock. So I did think, part of me was like, well, at least, you know, that's good. We've got an edge. We've got like an angle. So that might resonate with people a little bit more. So there you go. There's my yes and no answer. But again, I mean, you don't know.
If you do know, if you are the person who knows, please yeah. comment it below. Please.
Again, gonna have a lot of weird. You're gonna have a really weird mix of comments below.
Really looking forward to it. Yeah. It's usually pretty plain down there in the comments, but you know. Yeah.
Not sometimes, many people having fights on YouTube on your channel. That's I'd say that's a good thing.
Just bringing people together. No, but I'll get a comment every once in a while. I go, whoa, somebody commented on this. Just nice.
Nice.
I go, whoa, all right. Very, very. it just throws me. It throws me. But
it's a nice little surprise.
Yeah, absolutely. Sarah, I really appreciate you sitting down with me and chatting. It was an absolute pleasure, a good way to start my morning, and really thank you.
Oh, thank you, Jay. Well, I appreciate you sitting down and talking with me.
We're censoring that. I'm the one that's appreciative.
I appreciate you. appreciate you.
I appreciate you, Sarah. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Jake. It was so nice to talk to you.
Before we cut you loose here, we got some stuff to promote. So Los Bichos Music, streaming everywhere. Wherever you get your music, that's where you can find it. Of course, like we were talking about before, the debut album, Let the Festivities Begin. You can buy that online and it'll be linked below whatever you're listening to. There'll be a nice link to it. I definitely suggest buying that. Very good album. City Slang, right?
That's correct. Is
it? Okay. CitySlangRecords.com. We'll have it, and also that'll be linked below. And the new, now please tell, is it PAW? Am I pronouncing that?
PAW! Yeah, do it. Gotta have the hand.
PAW. This PAH, exclamation point. Then don't forget that.
Correct. PAW! Yeah.
Is the newest release from Los Bichos, and that's also at cityslang.com?
Everything City Slang. Yep.
Good deal. And Los Bichos on Instagram, just at Los Bichos. And when does the tour start? When does it start and when does it wrap up?
Which tour?
I get it. You're doing well. You're busy.
Which one?
the US one.
So we will be in San Diego, I think we said the 14th, right? Yes, April the 14th is when it kicks off, and then we wrap up in New York on the 2nd of May. All our dates, are there.
On the Instagram, like we said before, and on the store as well, right? At the store, maybe not at the store, but actually go to Hello Merch anyways and go pick up some merch. But
there's like a poster and stuff. All the dates there.
All cool stuff.
Yeah, absolutely. T-shirts and stuff that says Los Bichos on it. It's wicked.
Vinyl, CD. I think it's it for right now, but that's a lot of stuff. And you should go buy something.
Yeah, plenty of stuff. Absolutely.
Plenty. And are we missing anything, Sarah? Do we need to promote anything else?
Nah, just buy the 7-inch.
Buy the 7-inch.
Or like listen to it. Would be nice. Pa! And just have a nice time listening to it. That's all I ask.
That's tall order, but okay. Sarah, thank you so much.
Thank you.
I'm gonna stop recording this. I'll talk to you in a minute. Thank you.
Okay.
The best.